I became interested in science through my father because as a child, he would take me to school with him sometimes and I would listen to his lectures. At the time, my mother didn't think women had a possibility of a career in science. She thought that most women that she knew, you know, most they could do was teach in mostly elementary school. But my father had a philosophy that said you can be anything you want to be and no one can stop you if you put your mind to it.
Look at her, she's a bad man. She's got a figure that's shown up in attention. She's poetry in motion, a beautiful sight to see. I get so excited viewing her anatomy. She's real, she's strong, oh, she's got all the curves a man like. She's real, she's
why she fell so easily into being one of the forerunners of women, not only black women, but women in the computer era. Mm-hmm. Because when she worked, I remember her talking about the wind tunnel. I think it was with the Westinghouse or Western Electric.
She worked for Westinghouse.
Westinghouse. Yeah, she was part of those experimental teams that they were running then, with this wind tunnel and things like that, because that's the way her brain was. Because if you can stay so focused, you know, and you're not going to, she was never scattered. She was always on point. And she was very precise. So that's what you need when you're dealing with technology. Mm-hmm. And that's her personality. That was her personality. And not to say she didn't enjoy herself, because of course, if we were friends and we were buddies going now, you know, there were other times. But basically, that was her personality. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. That was a bit of a challenge, because in the newspaper, they had an advertisement that were going to hire 100 men. They're looking for engineers, 100 men that would be hired. She told her father, said, well, there's the job, but they're asking for 100 men. And granddad said, they're looking for engineers, and you're an engineer. No, okay, yeah, you got a point. So she went and took the interview. Now, she described the interview to me. Oh, wait a minute. Mom, you okay? You okay?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry?
Scratch my leg.
Oh, okay. You look like you're about to fall over there. That's, okay.
I was trying to do it and listen at the same time.
Okay. Well, feel free to correct me if I get anything wrong, you know? I remember her telling me about when she went to interview for the job at Westinghouse. When she first went there, the first gentleman she talked to said, well, all the jobs have been filled. And she looked at him and said, well, you're not the right person to interview me. I want to talk to the right person. I said, well, what makes you think I'm not the right person? Said, well, you're not used to interviewing professionals, people applying for professional jobs. So why do you say that? I'm standing here, you're interviewing me, and you haven't even offered me a seat. He said, oh, well, have a seat. No, I don't want to sit here and talk to you. You're not the right person. So he told the secretary to see her out. And so she asked, well, who should I talk to? And said, Mr. So-and-so said, you have to leave. So she leaned over and said, it won't hurt you. And she emphasized the word hurt. You know, it won't hurt you to tell me who to talk to. So the secretary caught that not too subtle hint and sent it to somebody else who interviewed and told her the same thing, and she still refused to accept that interview, said, you're not the right person either. And finally, the third time, they got it to the guy who was actually in charge of hiring people for that spot. He liked her credentials, he talked to her, thought she was impressive, and he hired her. Well, he wasn't the boss, he wasn't the big boss there. The big boss was not in the office. He was, I don't know, he was on vacation, or he was someplace else. And when he came in, he said, my mother's first meeting with him, the first time she saw this guy, she was sitting at a desk working, and this guy walks up and says, every time I leave, so-and-so brings in somebody strange. If I'd been here, you wouldn't have gotten hired. And she looked at him and said, if you'd been here, I wouldn't have accepted the job. And she continued to work, right? You know,
her office was right next to ours. When she was teaching computing, COBOL and that stuff, Dr. Gibson's office was down the hall, and the two of them like worked together. Dr. Gibson taught information systems, and Ms. Harvey taught the language for computing. At the time, they said that they went to IBM to take the exam for a job, and he was very late because what he did was he passed the test with flying colors, and the white kids were in there. and he said they were sweating bullets because they weren't familiar with the exam. And it was one of the exams that Ms. Harvey and Dr. Gibson had taught them.
Got all of those things settled. I said, listen, if you want to marry me, Tobago comes first. Tobago comes first because we are in a bad state in Tobago. We have no higher education and what have you. You have some school and you have no science. And we decided now to build a college in Tobago.
Well, I know there was a shortage of books. And I know she was saying, I think they had problem with space at first over there, getting the school started and all. And I know she when she came to visit here in Baltimore, she would let us know what the school needed, you know, at that time. And I know she got donations while she was here because I know several of the Morgan women were interested in donating, and especially books and things like that. And I know there were other things that the school needed, and I know that she did ask for donations. So, and then recently I saw a picture of the school, and I was impressed, you know.
Every is dead, Lord. I guess let's start with, so where were you born?
Well, Baltimore.
Oh, okay, all right. Naomi and Douglas Camper were your parents, right? Mm-hmm. And so what elementary school did you go to?
Elementary school, I went to the number of the school. The one on Carey Street.
It was on Carey Street?
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
I remember where it was. I can't remember. I didn't draw. Oh. 112.
Oh, okay, so it was 112 was the school number? Mm-hmm. Oh, okay, because I remember school numbers back then. And how about middle school or junior high school?
I went to Booker T. Washington Junior High School.
Okay.
I see, I don't know the number of that school. And then Douglas High School. High school.
Okay. Thank you. started talking about starting a school in Tobago?
Well, it wasn't surprising to me because, I mean, it's kind of, not her life's dream, but it was kind of her destiny, because she'd always been kind of a public servant. She'd always been dedicated to educating African Americans and getting them, a very quality education, because her and my dad both helped out with teaching kids, and they both were designing state-of-the-art important equipment for the U.S. government in the day, in the 50s and 60s and 70s, radar equipment and all that kind of stuff. So when they were teaching the kids at Morgan State, they were teaching them right from the source, basically. And they were also helping them get important jobs in the industry. And so when she retired from Morgan State, and she said that her and Murray were opening up a college in Tobago, well, I wasn't surprised at all.
Thank you.